Let's start with something very simple. What is motivation? It's usually defined as a direction and intensity of one's effort. So it's the first part is your effort should be directed in a certain direction. They should have a specific goal. So the first part is direction. The second part is how intense is your effort. So motivation is a combination of those two factors. Very simple. And we'll keep it that simple. Now, some practical guidelines about how it can be used. So, as we said, consider both situations and the traits of the person you're talking about. There can be many motivational factors that are contributing to a person's motivation. So, look at what all is happening. So, there are a few things listed there that a person can participate for more than one reason. People can have very conflicting motives. So, you know, I may want to win a game, but I may also want to be in some place else. So they may have conflicting motives in the same situation. People can have motives which are shared with other sportsmen they are playing with. So if they are in a team, they may have certain shared motives. Or in addition to that, there may be some factors which are uniquely motivating to them. There have been studies about gender differences in motivation. So different things motivate males, different things motivate females. Also, there are supposedly cultural factors in what motivates people. So certain cultures have, as we say, a culture of sports. So we need to look at what culture the person comes from, what kind of emphasis the culture gives on sports, how much is it considered important. So ideally, the coach or whoever is motivating should look at all these factors before considering how to motivate that person. And we need to observe it continuously because motivators can change over time. The ideal thing to do is, they say that instead of preaching, change the environment so that they get motivated, and change the environment based on the data that you got. Next thing we talk about is how to use rewards or reinforcement to increase motivation. So what is reinforcement? It is usually the use of rewards and punishment to increase or decrease the likelihood of certain behaviors, and so increase the or decrease the motivation for those behaviors. To create an environment that fosters pleasure, growth and mastery, professionals use motivational techniques based on principles of reinforcement. They are called various things. There are certain names which come up later. What are the basic principles? If you want to increase a certain behavior, reward it. If you want to decrease the motivation for a certain behavior, don't reward it or punish it. It's as simple as that in theory. The same reinforcer will work in different ways for different people. People, even though they are reinforced, especially sportsmen, may not be able to repeat the same behavior or get the same results. We must consider, therefore, all the reinforcements available to the individual and what is important to that person at that point in time. So what is a valued reinforcement to that person at that point in time? And there may be a lack of awareness regarding competing motives in the player's mind as well as in the motivator's mind. So there needs to be clarity about that also. So two simple approaches based on two simple ways of reinforcing. The positive approach says that you focus on behaviors which need to be improved, which need to be kept, for which the player needs to be kept motivated, and reward those behaviors. The negative approach is focus on punishing undesirable behaviors or not rewarding those behaviors so as to reduce those behaviors. Overall, the research that has been done over a lot of studies which have been happening over the years have generally recommend that the positive approach is better than the negative approach. So there are in fact studies which give you ratios. So they say that the ratio should be 4:1 or 5:1. So if you have used one punishment, there should be 4 or 5 rewards to balance for that. Of course, they are very theoretical, but there have been studies like that. So how to use positive reinforcement? As we said, sports psychologists recommend a positive approach. Research demonstrates that athletes who play for positive-oriented coaches like their teammates better, enjoy the athletic experience more, like their coaches more, and experience greater team cohesion. Now, various ways in which positive reinforcement can be used. It could be simple compliments, smiles, it could be a pat on the back, or it could be rewards in form of objects or something that the player covets. Not the best of ways of looking at it, but it's generally said that if you want to train a dog, you need to give the reward or punishment immediately after the expected or unexpected behavior is done. The same principles apply for humans, that you need to reward immediately, at least in the first part of the training. Another important thing, reward appropriate behaviors. Choosing the proper behaviors is critical because you may not be in a position to reward everything that the player does. Typically, what happens is we reward outcomes. So medals are given when you win. The general principle based on the research is that reward performance, not outcome. That keeps your players motivated. Feedback as a motivator, there is a bit about that. So as we said, feedback should be given at every stage because it can work as a motivator as well as it can help the player to shape his or her performance. They should not be, you know, random, you did not do well today. Yeah, great performance today. You know, let your feedback be more specific and related to a certain behavior. Now, feedback does two things, as we said. It motivates and it helps to instruct. And in both ways, it therefore helps to improve performance and keep the player motivated. Should we use punishment or not? Let's first focus on guidelines for using it. Be consistent in giving everyone the same type of punishment for breaking similar rules. Punish the behavior, not the person. Convey to the individual that it is his behavior that needs change and that not the person is faulty. Allow athletes to have input in making a punishment for breaking rules. So they can own up to those punishments and they know that, okay, this is going to be my punishment if certain rules are broken. Do not use physical activity as a punishment. So ground ke char chakkar aur lagao. Doesn't work. It may work on the fitness, but it may not be a very effective punishment. Make sure that a punishment is not perceived as a reward or as attention, because it can happen at times. So some people may do it because, okay, that is the only way they get attention. And so then it will become a rewarding experience rather than a punishment. Impose punishment impersonally. So it should be focused on behavior and it should not be person to person. Do not punish athletes for making errors while they are playing. Don't do it in front of the teammates or the classmates. Use punishment sparingly and enforce it when you use it. Do not punish everyone for a single person's mistakes. Make sure the punishment is age appropriate. Make certain athletes understand the reason for the punishment. So not just punish, but also there should be clarity about why it is happening. We'll come back a little to behavior modification. Reward system should be tailored. This is more of a summary. The strongest kind of motivation, though it's supposed to be intrinsic motivation, which comes from within the player and which is not based on external rewards and punishment system.
Two words, direction and intensity. And I think motivation is nothing but direction and intensity. So that has clarified something for me. The second point is that it's not only the personal trait, it is not only the situation, but it is the interaction between the situation and the person. So both things are important, person and the situation. Now, he talked about conflicting motivations. So many times this can happen practically. I remember a chess player with whom I was working, and this chess player was only 9 years of age. And he used to go to competitions. He's very good. He has a world ranking now. Now he has, of course, grown a little older. But at that time, he used to go for international competitions because in the aeroplane, there is no control over watching movies. And he would get pizzas. So, pizza, movies and Coke was his motivation to go and play good chess. Okay. And for his mother, you know, mother used to say that, no, his ranking should improve. He has to do so well. Essentially, there was this conflict in motivation. So I think it's very important that motivation of the team should be similar. You know, there has to be some amount of consensus on that motivation. Second point that I learned was that over time, motivations can change. Which means what motivated a player, say when the player was, 2 years into the game, may not motivate the player when he's 4 years in the game. You know, so that is something that we as coaches and parents, we need to keep in mind. And something that you said, Kuldeep, was very good, that change the environment so that the person feels motivated. Now, that is something which is very interesting. Now, the reinforcements about which you said is very, very interesting, that what values the person at that time. And there is a difference between rabbits and monkeys and human beings. For rabbits and monkeys, the same reinforcement will work. But for human beings, the reinforcements would change. You know, and I think that is a very, very important point. What works at what point? Now, the interesting part was punishment. Somehow, I felt or I generally feel that the word punishment has a very negative emotional tinge. I would always prefer a word penalty. Because there is a penalty for a mistake. See, what are the associations in our mind? There is a penalty for a mistake and there is a punishment for a crime. So, the moment you use the word punishment somewhere, on the background the word crime comes and not mistake. And therefore, the good word or the better word to use could be penalty. Because penalty is for an error. Penalty is for a mistake. So, I think we should, as parents, as coaches, we should have that clarity that what is the error and what is the mistake. And never go to the level of crime. Because, see, this is a very practical problem. When the coach and the parent are dealing with the player, it's not always goody-goody. Right? Let's face the reality that it's not goody-goody. And sometimes you require penalty. So, how do you do it? Very important way of penalizing is withhold the positive reinforcement. Withholding positive reinforcement is the best penalty. Because that is something for which your player is looking forward to. And what you are doing, you are not withdrawing, you are withholding. And what you are saying that if you change your behavior and show me the changed behavior for, you know, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, you are going to get it. So withholding a reward or withholding a positive reinforcement is one of the best policies, which books and research also recommends. Now see, another strategy is ignoring. Ignoring itself is a penalty, right? Which means you are not going towards negative, you are withdrawing positive in your behavior and you are telling that this is something that I have not liked and you will not receive any inputs, you know, for this. I think it's very important when you give penalty, take feedback about the penalty from that child or from that player after some time. Ki ye penalty ke samay tumhe kaise laga? Kyunki that is something which is finally very important, na? That what was the emotional experience during the penalty? It may be some 10 minutes, it could be 1 hour. But we are not interested in the action of penalty. We are interested in the emotions that it evokes. That if you have those negative emotions, you are less likely to repeat your behavior. So, feedback of penalty is also very important. Yes, Kuldeep?
Yeah. people participate in sports not just for extrinsic rewards, but also for their own goals. So when they are motivated by factors within themselves, then we are talking about internal motivation, intrinsic motivation. Now, current research says that intrinsic and extrinsic motivation as well as amotivation are on a continuum. So they are on a scale with amotivation at one end, then there are certain types of extrinsic motivation. At the center, there is something called a threshold of autonomy. We'll come back to that. But it's basically the point beyond which you have some say of your own in getting motivated. So there are two external motivators which also have some autonomy. That is, I can regulate them. And the internal motivators are, of course, self-regulated. How much do I determine whether I have that motivation or not is changing along the line. So at this end, where I'm very amotivated, there is no determination from myself. I can't do much. At the internal end, there is a lot of high internal, high self-determinism. That is, I am determining whether I'm motivated or not. Okay, everyone talks about this, that you should be passionate about what you do. What is passion? It's supposed to be an intrinsic motivation, which a motivator, which can give you sustained motivation. Passion has been defined as a strong inclination and desire towards an activity one likes, finds important, and invests time and energy in. When individuals like to engage in an activity on a regular basis, it will become part of their identity to the extent that it is highly valued. So then you become passionate about it. What is being in the flow? So this is the graphic for it. So on here, it's low skills to high skills and low challenge to high challenge. And a person who is in flow is on the top quadrant. The person below is bored because skills are high and the challenge is low. This person, low skills, low challenge, no emotions at all, apathetic. And high challenge, low skills, anxious. So you are in flow and things start going not as per expectations, you can just jump out of, get pushed out of flow. That was it.
Thank you, Kuldeep. Just to summarize what I learned out of this. Kuldeep gave us three factors in intrinsic motivation. He said that the intrinsic motivation is for knowledge and skills, for accomplishment and for stimulation. And I developed three words for it, that there are three satisfactions that a player derives. The first satisfaction is the satisfaction of involvement. The second is the satisfaction of mastery. And the third is satisfaction of winning moment. It's not fame. It's different from fame. You know, it's different from recognition. It's the winning feeling. So I think these three are key to intrinsic motivation. That first, satisfaction that I derive out of involvement, which means when I'm doing it, I'm feeling great. Secondly, mastery, that 2 months back I was here and now my level of mastery has increased. That experience or that emotional feeling. And the third is the feeling of winning. So I think these three are very important in your intrinsic motivation. What Kuldeep said was that recreation and competition, two tracks. Too much of recreation, too much of enjoyment, problem. Too much of competition, problem. So what do you do? You know, how do you balance the two? In fact, there was a question asked here that in practice, I am very confident. And in match, I am not that confident. What is the reason? The reason could very well lie here. Then in practice, it is too much of recreation. And in the match, it is only competition. So what is important is, what I tell my athletes in very simple terms, put some match into your practice and put some practice in your match. You know, that is something which is very important, that when I am doing my practice, I need to put some competition part into it. In terms of visualizing, that I am having
say as an athlete, I'm making a circle or I'm making a run, then I should visualize that this is a national final, you know, and I should go on visualizing it many times. Then I'm bringing competition to my practice, and then I'm not too much on the recreation part of it. And when I'm in competition, I still need to enjoy my game. So then you came to a very interesting point, passion. What you said was very interesting. It has to blend with individuality. Then only it becomes a passion. So blending with individuality is something which is very, very important. And to give you a very small little example, that one of my senior friends, he is a geologist. So he has passion for stones. So he looks at the world through the eyes of stone only. So when his family members took him to see the great film Sholay, so they asked him that, how was Sholay? He said, where Gabbar stays, na, there is this basalt. these were the stones over there. So his attention was more towards the stones than towards Gabbar. Now keep the humor apart, but what it meant was that for this geologist, it has become a part of his individuality. It has not remained a subject. You know, he sees everything from a geologist's frame, right? And that is what it must be, the meaning of blending with individuality. I think that is very essential for a flow. In flow, he said, there has to be a balance between challenge and skills, which is very, very important. You said that when the skills are less and the challenge is more, then anxiety. Again, our self-belief number two. If the skill is high and the challenge is high, self-belief three goes with flow. If the challenge is low and skill is high, bored, that is self-belief four. And apathy, that is low skill and low challenge, it goes with self-belief one. So again, self-belief that we studied yesterday, how it is linked to your flow, was something that I learned. Now it was very interesting. He said, clear goals. And then at one point he said that the external goal should not exist. Now that is something which is very intriguing. There should be clear goals and the external goal should get dissolved. What does that mean? It means a very interesting thing. The thing is, you are clear as far as what are the factors which are within your control and how to execute them, not about the results. So if you want to remove that apparent paradox, put the external goals aside, but work on the factors which are within your control, and that is something which is clarity. If you have seen that six sixes of Yuvraj Singh, and many times we say that during those six sixes he was in a flow. Now if you see that all the six sixes he has hit at different places in the ground, and it was not a blind hit, because the bowler every time had changed. Bowler has come over the wicket, round the wicket, the bowler had changed the drop of the ball, the bowler had changed the speed, and every time he has fended it in a different way. So what is very important is clear goal as to how am I going to face the ball. But at the same time, when you are in the flow, you are not counting runs. No, that is the dissolution of your external goal. So I think when words are given, it's very important for us to understand what those words mean, because otherwise they are in contrast. That external goal should not be taken in consideration, and clarity of goal. So what does it mean? What is interesting in flow, that a sense of control still exists. No, which is very, 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 very interesting. And I remember an example. I was reading a book which is written on that legendary singer Bal Gandharva. So this is a novel on his life. And Bal Gandharva was very tuned to singing for say 40 minutes, 45 minutes on stage. And he was called to cut a disc To cut a disc means at that time these gramophone discs had come in fashion, and he was called. Now there the gramophone disc is for say 5 minutes or 7 minutes, and Balgandharva was tuned to sing for say 30 minutes or 40 minutes, right? And what was astonishing for the people who were recording was that while he started singing, it was felt that he is in a flow. So the recordist used to wonder that when he is going to stop. But 20 seconds before 7 minutes, he used to stop. That is what it says, you know, there is a dissolution of self, yet there is a sense of control. Because if you don't have that sense of control, you will not stop at 7 minutes. And if you don't have dissolution of self, then you will not have the quality. So it's very interesting to learn, or putting your words into experiences as to how people are performing. And what is very important is effective practice is very important for flow. Unless your practice is effective, you cannot create flow. So that is something which came out of this.